I stood on the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rising up out of the sea, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and on his horns 10 crowns, and on his head a blasphemous name. Welcome to the Revelation 13 podcast.
Hello and welcome to the Revelation 13 podcast. I'm your host, Mike Hopwood. In today's world, many people live in large, sprawling cities, far from the woods, swamps, and mountains that exist throughout North America. Outside of these modern cities, there is a vast wilderness, and in this wilderness, there exists many forms of life, most of which has been identified and categorized. But there remains at least one creature that has eluded identification by science. It travels between the roads of myth and reality. Man and ape, animal and monster. The elusive phantom has many names given to it by native tribes that have encountered it in the ancient past. Today the creature is best known as Bigfoot due to the large man-like prints it leaves behind. Those who have encountered this creature have witnessed a rare sight, and these are some of their stories. October 1955, near Mica Mountain, Alberta, Canada. William Rowe, a seasoned trapper and hunter, was scouting out an area near an old abandoned mine. Around 3 p.m., he stepped into a clearing. He noticed what he first thought was a grizzly bear in the bushes on the far side of the clearing. When the creature came into the clearing, William Rowe could plainly see that what he was looking at was not a bear. He thought perhaps it was a large man in a fur coat, or even an actor dressed in a gorilla costume for a movie. The longer he looked at the creature, he could tell it was not a man. When it came within 20 feet of Rowe, it stopped, squatted down, and began eating leaves off a bush. After a couple of minutes, the creature seemed to notice William Rowe's scent. It looked around and then looked directly at Rowe. It moved back 4 steps, stood up, and walked off rapidly, looking back at the area Rowe was hiding in. William Rowe raised his rifle at the creature. As he saw it looking back at him, he felt he couldn't shoot it. It seemed too human. When it reached the far side of the clearing, it tipped its head back and let out a howl, and then disappeared into the woods. Rowe would see it a few minutes later as it crossed a ridge 200 yards distant. It again let out a howl as it walked away. William Rowe would not see the creature again. Rowe would write down his observations about the creature he saw. It stood well over 6 feet tall. Its shoulders were about 3 feet across. He guessed its weight at about 400 pounds. The creature was probably female due to its large breasts. It had dark brown fur about 1 inch long. Its arms were muscular and long-reaching, almost to its knees. The feet of the creature was large and wide, about 5 inches across. Its skin on the underside of the foot was gray-brown. As it walked, it put its heel down first and seemed to glide along. Its head was higher in the back than in the front. The nose was broad and flat. The creature's lips and chin jutted forward. The ears were the same as humans. Its eyes were small and black, similar to a bear's. The skin around the eyes and mouth had no hair, and the face was capable of expression. When the creature looked at Rowe for the last time, it had an amazed look on its face. Many of the traits that Rowe reported the creature had would be repeated by others from different sightings over the years. In the autumn of 1957, in the forest near Bend, Oregon, Gary Jonas and Jim Newell were hunting deer in the woods. Jonas shot a deer in a clearing. As the hunting team began walking to the clearing to collect the deer, he noticed a hairy, upright walking creature come out of the woods. It grabbed the deer, turned around, and started walking back into the woods. Gary Jonas shouted at the creature, angry that something was stealing his kill. When it didn't react, Jonas fired a shot at it. Jonas would then hear the shrill whistle that the creature emitted before disappearing into the brush. Jonas was certain that he had hit the hairy beast, but it showed no signs of it being injured. 1959, Hidden Lake, British Columbia. Mr. and Mrs. Bellevue were camping in the area. When Miss Bellevue went out to gather firewood, she noticed a human-like figure looking at her from the trees. The creature stood about 6 feet tall and was covered with reddish-brown hair. Miss Bellevue quickly went back to where she and her husband were camping. Miss Bellevue decided not to mention anything to her husband, for fear of ridicule. Later that night, she suggested to her husband that they should camp elsewhere. Her husband agreed, saying that he had been getting a very strong feeling that they were not welcome in the area. When the next morning came, they started packing up. As they were doing this, they could hear something large and bipedal lumbering in the dense undergrowth around them. They were fortunately able to leave the area without encountering the creature further. Davis, West Virginia, 1960. Some teens were camping in the woods, and one of the teenagers felt someone poking his ribs. Turning around to see who was trying to get his attention, he saw an 8-foot ape-like figure covered in shaggy hair. The teen noticed that the eyes glowed as if they had some sort of inner fire. After startling the teen, the creature walked back into the trees. 1960, near Clanton, Alabama. The Reverend E.C. Hand and six others saw an ape-like creature moving along Route 31. They notified Sheriff T.J. Lockhart. When Lockhart investigated the area the creature had been seen, he found two sets of tracks, one larger, one smaller. The larger prints were about the size of a man's foot, with the big toe sticking out sideways. The smaller prints had the same sticking out sideways toe, but were half the size of the other footprints. 1961, near Alpine, Oregon, Larry Martin was hunting deer with a friend. They traveled to an area where Martin had earlier shot a deer. They started tracking the wounded deer to where it had collapsed. They found the spot where the deer had been, but it was gone. There was obvious drag marks that led towards a dense patch of undergrowth. When they went into the undergrowth, the bushes within them began to shake violently. Then the men saw the creature come into view. Martin would estimate its height at 7 feet, with a head and face similar to that of a gorilla. The Bigfoot creature was only standing a few feet away from Larry Martin and his friend. Mr. Martin didn't hang around long. He let out a scream and fled the area.
The creature followed them until they reached their car. As they sped off, they saw the creature watching them leave. June 1961, near Fort Brass, California. On an isolated farm owned by Robert Hatfield, late one night, Mr. Hatfield's dogs began to bark. Hatfield went to investigate the reason for the commotion from the front porch. He noticed a head standing above the 6-foot fence that surrounded his yard. Hatfield assumed it was a bear and went back into the house to have his brother-in-law bring a flashlight and a rifle. Hearing a noise around the corner of the house, Hatfield went back outside to see what made the noise. When he did, he nearly bumped into an 8-foot hairy human-like figure. Hatfield ran away from the creature and dashed into the house as fast as he could. He screamed at his sister to shut the door. When she tried to close the door, something held it from closing completely. Bud Jenkins had found his rifle and flashlight and told his wife to let it through, that he would get it. Before his wife could, the door went slack and she closed and bolted it. Bud Jenkins looked out the window and saw the creature walk off and step over a 3-foot fence before disappearing into the night. The summer of 1961 would produce reports of Bigfoot creatures with uncommon hair color. In August, near Stony Lake, British Columbia, Alex Lindstrom reported seeing an 8-foot grain-colored creature that